start the prescription writing. So I will call by the name. So you should be ready. Everybody should be ready, okay? Because I have given 1 day time for preparation of 4 questions only. Roll number 80. Roll number 80. Raunak Raj. Are you there? Roll number 80. Raunak. Samrat Paudel. Samrat. Hello, Samrat.
Hello, is. Hello, ma'am.
Okay. You switch on your video.
Hello, ma'am.
Hello. Samrat?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you switch on your video? Camera?
I don't have camera in my device, ma'am.
You don't have camera? How come?
Yes, ma'am.
Why? Every mobile, every laptop, they have camera, no?
No, ma'am, I'm using desktop.
Desktop, okay. So, can you write or can you say the prescription for open angle glaucoma? How will you start with the prescription writing? Tell me from the very beginning, okay? So what are the things, components required while writing a good prescription? Should be, it is a legal document, no? Whenever it is required, you have to show it as a legal document. So everything should be there, okay? Whatever is required. So what is the first step of writing prescription? Tell me. How will you start writing prescription?
Name of patient is?
Okay.
And about patient details, address, and diagnosis.
No, before diagnosis, any other demographic profile is required, any other things?
License number.
Is there any requirement of the doctor's information?
Yes, license number and name of the doctor.
Okay, name or any other about the doctor, only name is sufficient. This is a legal document, no?
License if, number, ma'am, that okay, given by.
Okay, if it is from the Nepal, you should write an NMC number. Okay, if it is from the India, you should write MCI number. Okay, license number of the doctor. Then name of the doctor is very essential. And you should give or you should write your contact number as well. Because in case of any emergency, the patient can directly call to you, even at the night time also, okay? Because in sometimes the drugs may produce the severe adverse drug reaction, or sometimes the drugs may not work in that condition, emergency condition, the patient can directly contact to you, okay? So the contact number of the doctor is also very, very essential in prescription writing. Likewise, the contact number of the patient is also very essential. Why it is essential?
If some problems with patient happen, or if the diagnosis, if the drugs prescribed is something inappropriate, then we can change.
Sometimes the doctors may be in a hurry, okay, so that the doctors may write the wrong drugs, and after patient leaving from the hospitals, they may realize that, oh, I have written some unwanted drugs or not that drugs which is not required to the patient, okay? So in that condition, the doctor will immediately call the patient and ask to come to his clinic, or he can advise to the patient on phone call also, okay? So for that reason, contact number of the patient is also very important. Clear? So what is the importance of address of doctor as well as the patient.
Ma'am, if the patient have some problem, then they can come directly to us at any time.
Anytime, okay.
So doctor's address is important.
And patient address?
Patient, if that some, that I don't know, ma'am.
Patient address is also for the same reason, no? If some emergency and the patient cannot come to the hospital because of some transportation, lack of transportation facility and all, the doctor may directly visit to the patient place. Okay, that is one thing. The other thing is some drug or some disease, they are prevalent in some area, okay, endemic, right? In some, like in Tarai region, there is a malaria endemic region. So to find out the endemic condition, endemic disease condition also, the address is very much important so that the doctors will prescribe accordingly, no? Like in case of the malaria patient. So if the person is come from the endemic area, the doctors will prescribe accordingly, no? That is also an important reason, okay, for writing the address of the patient. Clear? So you should know the importance of each everything, okay? What is the importance of the name? What is the importance of age? What is the importance of address, contact number? So every component, they have their own importance, okay? So you should not miss not a single point, okay? You should write all these things in details. It also carries a legal document, okay? And sometimes the patient may die because of the negligence of the doctor. Okay, in that condition, it is a legal document. So you have to bring this document to the court for your justification. Whether the doctor has done negligence or it is by mistake or it is a patient mistake. So to prove that, you should keep as a legal document. Clear that prescription. So for this reason, you have to write everything that is required in a good or legal prescription. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, Samrat, let's begin our topic. So how will you prescribe a patient of open angle glaucoma? So first you should know what is open angle glaucoma. Okay, without knowing the disease, you cannot write the drug name. So what is a open angle glaucoma? First tell me. You know glaucoma?
Yes, ma'am.
What is glaucoma?
It is the condition in which the intraocular pressure is increased. Intraocular tension is increased more than 21 mm of Hg. That can cause progressive optic nerve damage.
Hello, Samrat. Hello. Hello, can you hear me?
Ma'am, we can hear you.
Okay. So, for a few minutes, light went here. So, there was no internet. There is a disconnection. Right now, okay, you can start. What is open angle glaucoma?
Ma'am, glaucoma is the condition in which there is a rise in intraocular pressure that progressively causes the optical nerve damage.
Okay, that is a glaucoma. Okay, what are the types of glaucoma you know?
open angle and angle closer glaucoma.
Okay, these are two. Simple chronic glaucoma or acute congestive glaucoma. So what is open angle glaucoma? What is acute congestive glaucoma? Should be able to differentiate between these two. What happens in open angle glaucoma?
Ma'am, the trabecular meshwork is affected.
Okay. Is there any narrowing of the iridocorneal angle or not? The flow of the aqueous humor is, there is a good flow or there is a any disturbance in the flow of,
iridocorneal angle is increased.
Iridocorneal angle is not narrow in open angle glaucoma, but there is a defect in the trabecular meshwork, so that the outflow of the aqueous humor is disrupted. Okay, so after the prolonged period of the open angle glaucoma, there will be slightly increase in the rise of the intraocular pressure. Okay, so that is a open angle glaucoma. It is not an emergency condition, it is a chronic condition. Okay, so how will you treat this?
And we can give beta adrenergic blockers like timolol, beta and prostaglandin analogs like latanoprost, carbonic anhydrase, acetazolamide.
Okay, so these are the drug, but in the prescription you have to write a single drug, or if it is required you can give two drug, but you cannot write all the drugs. Okay, you should select one effective drug for the patient in the prescription writing. If somebody asks what are the drugs that can be given in open angle glaucoma, you can say that these are the different drugs which we can give in open angle glaucoma. But if it is a case of prescription writing, you have to write a certain drug. Okay, you should not write all the drugs that are available for the certain disease. So what is the drug, best drug for the open angle glaucoma?
Ma'am, beta blockers, timolol.
Okay, timolol. What is the dose of timolol?
0.25 to 0.5% eye drops.
Okay, eye drop. How many times you have to give timolol?
Twice a day, ma'am.
Okay, twice or thrice. Sometimes you can give thrice a day also, but can give initially twice a day timolol. Okay, it is a beta blocker, selective or non-selective beta blocker.
Non-selective beta blocker.
Okay, non-selective beta blockers. So what are the precautions to be taken while you are instilling this timolol in your eyes? What may be the side effect?
It can enter systematically through the inner canthus. So when we are using timolol, we should give pressure at inner canthus to avoid systemic entry of drug.
To press the lacrimal duct, nasolacrimal duct. We have nasolacrimal duct here. Okay. When you instill the eye drops, so immediately it can go through the nasolacrimal duct into your blood circulation. Okay, that may give other cardiovascular side effect. So to prevent that, immediately instilling this eye drop into your eye, you can press the inner canthus of the eye. Okay, to prevent this adverse drug reaction of timolol. Okay, this is the important precaution or important advice you have to give to the patient. Okay, while prescribing timolol. So how will you write in the prescription? First, what you have to write, diagnosis is open angle glaucoma. Okay, first you have to write the diagnosis, and then after diagnosis, what you have to write?
Treatment.
Okay, treatment. How will you start with the treatment?
Name of drug and yes. Doses, duration, time of duration, that
In the first line, you just write the dosage form of the drug, like timolol is available as the eye drop. Okay, first you have to write eye drop, timolol, and the percentage or the amount of the drug. Okay, so this is the timolol. No, so timolol is eye drop, it is available in the eye drop. So you have to write eye drop timolol 0.25%. Okay, in the first line, you just write it. Doses form, drug, and the dose. Okay. And in the second line, in the direction, you have to write other everything. Like administer 2 drops in each eye twice a day for how many days? Okay, you can advise the patient for 15 days or for the 1 month. Clear? Direction. And the dispense. So how many bottle or how many vial or how many whatever. Okay. You have to dispense. You have to write in the dispense. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So you can dispense initially 1 bottle. Okay. 1 bottle is sufficient for 15 days. So if you are giving for the 1 month, then you can dispense or you write the dispense 2 bottle of eye drop timolol. Okay. So after then you have to follow up the patient. So after how many days you have to follow up the patient?
Maybe 15 days or 1 or 2 weeks.
Okay. So if you are prescribing the drugs for 15 days, you follow up the patient after 15 days. Okay. If you are prescribing the drugs for 1 month, then you can follow up the patient after 1 month. Clear? And at last, what is the another important things required in the prescription writing? After all this, last. Any advice is required in this condition? You have just told, no? Yes. Advice regarding the use of the drug.
Directions regarding the use of drugs.
Okay, that you can write in advice. Okay, in the advice, you suggest the patient that you should press your inner canthus of the eye after you put the eye drops in your eye. Okay, this is the important advice while you are giving this timolol. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So at last, you should do your signature. Okay, doctor's signature is also very important. So this is how you write the full prescription. Clear, Samrat?
Yes, ma'am.
So understand everybody? You have any doubt regarding the open angle glaucoma? If it is clear, then we can proceed to next question. So at last you should do your signature, okay? So what is our next question? Prescription for
myasthenia gravis.
Okay, myasthenia gravis. So how will you prescribe a patient suffering from myasthenia gravis? Anybody? Sujata? Sujata Mahato.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, tell me, how will you prescribe a patient suffering from myasthenia gravis?
Ma'am,
can you open your video?
No, ma'am.
Why?
Network quality is not good.
Okay, from next time, you have to switch on your video also while you are presenting. You should switch on your video also. Okay, be prepared for that.
Okay,
Sujata, tell me, how will you write the prescription for myasthenia gravis?
First, Ma'am, that is treatment or some first name of the person.
You should write in your manual, but now you can just send the process also. First, you should write the doctor's name, address, and all these things, and about the patient. You should write everything about the patient. Then you start with the prescription. Okay, tell me, what is the drug you are going to prescribe?
Ma'am, I will advise neostigmine.
Okay, neostigmine. What is the dose?
15 mg for 4 times a day.
4 times a day? Why 4 times a day? What is the half-life of neostigmine?
That I forgot, ma'am, but it has for duration of time.
From where you have copied this? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
So, what is your reference for this?
Not on this.
From where you have copied this, or from where you have written this dose and duration? From the Google, from the book, the standard book. From where?
From slide, ma'am.
From slide? So for how many days? Yeah, drug you can give neostigmine. Any other drug you can give in myasthenia gravis better than this?
Pyridoxine.
Okay, it's a natural alkaloid. Okay, pyridoxine. So either you can give neostigmine or you can give pyridoxine. But while you compare with these two, pyridoxine is more safe and it has a long half-life than neostigmine. So no need of giving frequent dose is that of neostigmine. If you are giving prescribing neostigmine, you have to give 4 times a day, no? But if you give pyridoxine, you can give 3 times a day. Okay. But you can give either pyridoxine or neostigmine in patient with myasthenia gravis. So if you are giving pyridoxine, the dose is, do you know the dose of pyridoxine?
50 mg.
You can give 15 to 30 mg. Okay, if it is an adult patient, you can start with the 15 mg or 30 mg. But if it is a case of the children, you have to reduce the dose. Okay, you have to calculate according to the weight of the children. So for the children, you have to give 0.5 to 1 mg per kg. Okay, if the child patient is 10 kg, then you can give 10 mg. Like this, you have to calculate. Okay, 0.5 to 1 milligram per kg in case of children, whereas 15 to 30. Okay, you can start with the 30 milligram 3 times a day for the adult patient. Okay, you can prescribe this for 30 days, okay, 1 month, and after 1 month, you have to follow up the patient. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So, in some condition, while you are giving these drugs in case of myasthenia gravis, you have to titrate the dose. You have to see the clinical improvement in the patient or not. Accordingly, you have to titrate the dose. Okay. If the clinical symptoms is not improved in a patient, then you have to increase the dose. Yeah. And if there is a toxicity or if there is an overdose of the pyridoxine of in between treatment period, if there is any cholinergic crisis, okay, due to the overdose of the pyridoxine or the neostigmine, in that condition, you have to decrease the dose of the drug. So you have to titrate the dose accordingly. Okay, either the symptoms is deteriorating or it is improving. Clear? Then you can follow up the patient after 1 month. 30 days again, you have to give the same drug to the patient, or if it requires another other drugs in that condition, you can change to alternative drugs, or you can give another drug as well. Okay. Sujata, are you clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Anybody? It's not clear about myasthenia gravis prescription. So if you have any doubt, you can ask Sujata. No doubt at all. That's fine. So we can proceed to next question. So next prescription is prescribed for the patient suffering from nasal congestion. Who is going to answer this? Manish Saulagai. Manish.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, tell me. How will you treat the patient of nasal congestion? How will you prescribe?
And we can use nasal decongestants.
Like?
Topical, like oxymetazoline.
Okay.
And dalmetazoline and oral phenylephrine.
That is not the way of writing your prescription. Okay. You should properly tell. So what is the dose? What is the frequency? For how long you have to give? What are the advices required for the patient? Manish, which drug are you going to prescribe first?
Oxymetazoline.
Okay, oxymetazoline. What is the dose?
0.1%.
Okay, 0.1%. So what is the direction?
The patient. Application on the nose, mucosa of nose.
Mucosa?
Nasal mucosa.
You can say nasal drop, no? You can drop in your nose. Two drops in its nostril. How many times? How many times?
Twice a day.
You can give 3 times a day, okay, every 8 hourly. So nasal drop first, initially in the first line, you have to write nasal drop oxymetazoline 0.1%. Okay, in the direction, you have to write 2 drops, okay, in steel, other drop, 2 drops in its nostrils, 8 hourly. That means 3 times a day for how long you want to prescribe? For 5 days, 7 days.
Till the congestion is not recovered.
That is not the way of prescribing, okay? How the patient knows that I have to stop in this time. So you are the doctors, you have to prescribe. You should know if this drug is used for the long term, either it has any side effect or not. So that is your job, no? To decide for how long I have to prescribe this drug to a particular patient. Any other? Ganesh Parivar? Ganesh?
Yes, ma'am.
So, for how long you are going to prescribe a nasal drop, oxymetazoline? For how long? 1 month, 2 months, or 1 year, or 5 days, 1 day, 2 days, for how long? No idea?
Confusing, man.
What you have written in your prescription? Have you written in copy or not, these things?
Yes, ma'am.
So, what you have written, read that.
from initial, the person's name, age, sex, date of admission.
Yes.
And
for how long? On. Gather consistent drops for minimum time, okay? For 5 to 7 days, not more than 10 days. Otherwise, there may be chance of rebound decongestion, nasal congestion, okay? The patient is not relieved by this drop, okay, local drop, then you can go to the other oral medication, okay? Because if you use this nasal drop for the long term, and after stopping these drops, there may be chance of rebound congestion. Clear? So to prevent that, these drugs should be given for the minimum period of time. At least you can give for 5 to 7 days, not more than that. Clear?
Yes, ma'am, it's clear.
Okay. So if the patient is not relieved, then you can go to other alternative treatment. Okay, oral congestion like the phenylephedrine and other. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
So here you advise the patient that the patient, they can take the warm water, okay, warm vapor by using some Vicks and other, that will also relieve, no? Soup, they should take warm soup, other liquidy food. So this type of advice you can give to the patient of nasal congestion. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So our last question is prescription for benign prostatic hyperplasia. Okay. In short, we can say BPH, benign prostatic hyperplasia or hypertrophy. So I will ask Nivia Oswald. Nivia, are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, tell me, how will you prescribe a patient of BPH? First, you should tell what is BPH.
I don't know, ma'am.
You don't know?
No, ma'am, I don't know.
I have given 1 day time for this preparation. Even you don't know what is BPH. What is the drug you are going to prescribe for this patient? What you have written in your homework copy? Nivia, this is not acceptable, okay? From the next time, if you do same things, I will mark you absent. Because I have given a whole day for the preparation. Yes or no?
Yes.
Even you don't know what is BPH, what is the drug for BPH? Okay, mind it. I will not accept from the next time. I will mark you absent. Okay, this is the first time I am giving you excuse.
Okay.
Anybody can answer? What is BPH? How will you prescribe a patient of BPH? Sulabh Thapa, roll number 92. Sulabh?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, tell me, what is BPH?
It is the benign prostatic hyperplasia.
Okay, what happened in BPH?
There is a urinary retention due to the hyperplasia of the prostatic gland.
Okay, so how will you proceed with the treatment?
Alpha blockers such as the tamsulosin can be given 0.4 okay. milligram orally 2 times a day.
Any other alpha blockers are there?
Erazosin 1 milligram yeah. orally 2 times a day can okay. be given.
Which one is more preferable alpha blocker?
Tamsulosin is more preferred.
Why? Why?
Because of high efficacy.
High efficacy. Both are more efficacious. Both are equal efficacious.
Less amount of side effect in case of the tamsulosin. So.
Okay, because both of them are the alpha blockers, selective alpha blockers. But in alpha also we have the different alpha 1A, alpha 1B, okay, different receptors. So in our prostate, in the prostate, there is a selective more, there is a more alpha 1A receptor. Okay, so this tamsulosin is more selective to alpha 1A receptors that is present in the bladder, neck or the urethra. Okay, that's why this tamsulosin is more selective for the BPH, clear, than other prazosin, terazosin, other alpha blockers, clear, because it is more selective to alpha 1A receptor, which is mostly abundantly present in urinary bladder, okay, bladder neck. That's why tamsulosin is more preferable than other alpha blockers like prazosin, terazosin, but you can give, okay. If this tamsulosin is not available or in some condition it cannot be given, okay, in some susceptible individuals, in that condition you can give prazosin or terazosin. But the first choice of drugs is tamsulosin, okay?
Okay, ma'am.
So the dose is?
0.4 milligram orally, 2 times a day.
Okay, 0.4 milligram orally, 2 times a day for how long you are prescribing?
For about 6 years also.
6 years? 6 days or 6 years?
6 days, ma'am.
You cannot prescribe the patient in the prescription. You cannot write 1 year, 2 year, 3 year. Okay, if it is a lifelong treatment also, but you have to follow up the patient in between. Okay, to see the progression of the disease. Either the drug has to be changed or the drug should be combined with the other drugs. So always you have to follow up the patient after a certain duration of the time. Okay. So initially you can write for 15 days or the 30 days. So after that period, you can follow up the patient and see the progression of the disease. Okay. Either the disease condition is progressing or not. So if the disease is satisfactory and progression is satisfactory, then you can continue with the same drug. Okay. But if it is not satisfactory or the disease condition is deteriorating, then you can give another alternative drugs or you can combine these drugs with another drug. Okay, that's why you should write a certain duration only. Okay, not for 1 year, 2 years like this. And any other drugs is required in this condition, BPS?
Finasteride can be given.
Okay, tablet finasteride. What is finasteride? Why it is given? How does tamsulosin work in BPS?
It helps in the relaxation of the sphincters and contraction of the smooth muscles of the bladder.
Okay, it causes the vascular, that is a relaxation of the vascular smooth muscles. Because of the contraction of the vascular smooth muscles, there is a difficulty in urination. Okay, so by blocking the alpha receptor, it causes the vascular relaxation. Okay, this is the how this is how these drugs work. And the next drug is finasteride. So what is finasteride? You don't know?
No, ma'am.
Okay, next, Sneha Raj. Sneha. Are you there? You are not there? Ritika. Ritika, roll number 73.
Yes, ma'am.
So why you are giving finasteride in BPH? You know what is BPH? Yes or no? Yes. You know or you don't know? Don't waste time.
Benign prostatic hypertrophy.
Oh, that is benign prostatic hypertrophy. Okay. Why you are giving the finasteride in BPH along with tamsulosin or along with the other alpha blockers? Why?
I don't know.
Anybody know this answer?
Ma'am, it causes the increasing size of prostate gland, but okay. Tamsulosin only causes the dilation of uterus.
Okay, how does it decrease the prostate size? Do you know the mechanism?
I don't know that.
You should know, no? So why you are prescribing the drugs, you should know how does this drug work. Otherwise, how will you prescribe? Randomly, without knowing any reason? This is not acceptable, okay? While you are prescribing the drug, you should know the mechanism, okay? You should know why I am prescribing the certain drugs to the particular disease, okay? So this finasteride is a 5-alpha reductase inhibitor, okay? This is an enzyme which is required for the conversion of testosterone into dihydrotestosterone. Here, so this testosterone is a intracellular androgens, okay? That is required or that is essential for the growth of the prostate gland. Okay, so while you are inhibiting this 5-alpha reductase, the testosterone cannot be converted to dihydrotestosterone, so that there is no overgrowth of the prostate gland because of the lack of the androgen. Okay, active androgen, active form of the androgen. Okay, this dihydrotestosterone is the active form of the testosterone. So we are inhibiting the enzymes for the formation of active form of the androgen, dihydrotestosterone, thereby decreasing the size of the prostate gland. So this is the rationale of giving this finasteride in benign prostatic hypertrophy or benign prostatic hyperplasia. So one drug that causes relaxation or of the smooth muscles and another drug that decreases the prostate size. So when these two drugs are combined, the effect is very good. Clear? That's why we are combining these two drugs. Okay, one is the alpha blockers. The next drug is the 5-alpha reductase inhibitors that reduce the size of the prostate. So that side by side, what happened? The prostate size is decreasing and there is a easy flow of the urine because of the relaxation. Okay. So there is no urinary retention and there is no painful micturition in a prostate patient, BPH patient. So you should know the reason, okay? You should know the rationale, you should know the mechanism of the action of the given drug. So the dose of this finasteride, what is the dose of this drug, finasteride? Ranjana?
Ma'am, it's given for 6 months, but
that is the duration, okay? What is the dose? First, you should know the dose of the drug. While writing the prescription, first you should know what is the dosage form. Either it is tablet, or it is an eye drop, or it is an injection, okay? Or it is any other dosage form. That is very much important. And after you know the that is dosage form, you should know the dose of the particular drug, okay? That means either it is a 10 milligram, 5 milligram, or 100 milligram. Yes or no? So you can start with the minimum dose, okay? 5 milligram, okay? Finasteride, 5 milligram orally once a day. Because of its long half-life, you can give only once a day. Clear? For at least 30 days, because sometimes these drugs should be taken for the long term. Okay. And after all, if the drugs is not working efficiently, then you can go for the surgical procedure. The surgical procedure is known as TURP. Okay. that is a resection of the prostate gland, transurethral resection of the prostate. Okay, in short, we can say TURP. Okay, that is the surgical procedure for BPH. If the drugs is not working efficiently, then you can go for the surgery. The surgery is known as TURP. But in the prescription, no need to write the surgical things. Okay, you can just prescribe the patient with certain drug. So these are the very effective two effective drugs in the patient of BPH. Clear? Any doubt? Ranjana, are you clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Apana. Arpana. Are you Arpana or Apana?
Ma'am, Aparna.
Aparna, are you clear? What is BPH?
Yes, ma'am. Yes,
ma'am. How do you prescribe? What are the drugs required for BPH? And what is the rationale of giving these drugs? What is the mechanism of action?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, from the next practical, everybody should be prepared, okay? And you should show your face, you should show your video as well while speaking. Okay, while you are presenting, you should switch on your camera as well. Okay, so these are the some important instructions you should follow in the practical. So any